Hello and welcome to the GenXplainers podcast, The Perfect Song. I'd like to say hello to the panel. Hello, Mike. Hello, Alan.
Hello.
Hello.
And the song is brought to us by Mike. Hey, Mike, what are you laughing about? Tell us about the song. Tell us about the song you brought.
I chose Amy Winehouse's Back to Black, which is off her album, Back to Black. Songs written by Amy Winehouse and Mark Ronson, who's a well-known producer. And he's helped her craft the sound for the album and all that. And also, what I like so much about is the background, the band that she uses, the Dap Kings, who also are really big with Sharon Jones and the Dap Kings. They were with Sharon Jones for years. Unfortunately, both Amy and Sharon Jones are no longer with us in this world. When the album was released, I know that she had a couple of hits. One big hit right off the bat, which is Rehab. This was the title track, which I think is the stronger of the songs on the album, and of the ones that made it on the radio. And I do think that what she was really well known for on her sound was creating this throwback sound to those girl groups of the 50s and 60s that, she said she modeled this album off of the sound of the Shangri-Las. Mm. A specific song that she said that this influence for this song was called Remember Walking in the Sand by the Shangri-Las. She was looking to create the album, and her management team introduced her to Mark Ronson. He walked away, came back the next day with the piano part of the song and just did a little demo for her. And within that day, 24 hours, they'd written the whole song, which I thought was pretty amazing for being a song that's so layered with sounds. They sort of say it's a nod to the production of Phil Spector and what he did with a lot of groups called the Wall of Sound. Mm. So this just layer upon layer upon layer of instrumentations that they put in the song and create this specific kind of sound that he was well known for. And so they sort of took that approach to the album and the song. It is voted number 33, not 36. On the Rolling Stones 500 songs of all time. So I'm making that reference because our previous episode, Alan's was 36 and this one's 33. So
they were close.
it is a contest.
That's exactly contest. That's exactly what it is.
No. Well, okay, I already know what my vote is now.
Anyway, the album propelled Winehouse into like stardom. I mean, it debuted at number 7 on the Billboard charts. It just became like a runaway hit. She won like 5 Grammys with it. It became the UK album of that year. It's the second highest selling UK album of the 21st century. And so like it just was a massive, massive hit for being her second album and her last album. So, and then she passed away in 2000. This came out in 2007. She passed away in 2011, becoming a member of the 27 Club, which was a club that a famous artist passed away at the age of 27. And she's one of them now.
So Al, why don't you start with your feelings on the song?
Yeah, if I was listening to this song for the first time and not listening closely, I would think it is from the 60s and from one of those girl groups from the 60s. I mean, it really does capture that energy and that feel so well, but it is, I think, in, I don't want to say transcendent of that, because those are some great songs as well, but it's darker than any of the girl groups ever went in the 60s. To the best of my knowledge, I'm certainly no expert, but that piano that I guess Mark Ronson, that was the first piece of the song that was created, that little piano, that's the only kind of bright part to it. Which is also, I think, why I really like that part, because it sort of stands out against the rest of this sort of lush, rich, but very dark kind of music and rhythm. And of course, her voice is so rich and low and has a darkness to it.
When she made the album, it was during the time when she was had broken up with her then boyfriend, I believe, and then they got back together and married later on. But yeah, it was very during a very dark period where she was going through a lot of turmoil personally. Yeah. So that comes out throughout the whole album.
Mm-hmm. Sure. And in a song called Back to Black, one would kind of expect.
From the album Back to Black.
Yes. And I think lyrically, this particular song, there's so many different ways you could read certain elements of it, but I think that it works so well from that being one of those really amazing breakup songs, heartbreak and breakup songs.
Yeah. But yes, I would agree with that. I would also add there's a real kind of strength to her in this song, though. Like she is heartbroken, but she's not pining. She's kind of like, all right, well, you're going to go, you know, get with some girl, do the easy thing. I'm just going to carry on. I'm going to go back to black.
And I feel like her sort of attitude about it, like she's not pining, you're right. But, and she is singing about, you know, I'm going to go to my back to black. I'm going to a dark place. It's not like she's, obviously she's not happy about it, but she's also not expressing herself for any kind of pity. In other words, she's not saying, oh, poor me, look what happened. She's just sort of matter of fact saying, well, I go back to black because that's who that's me. And that's how I am. And it's, I mean, you know, I'm obviously it's point of interpretation, but it feels to me like she's not like whining about anything. Amy Winehouse. She's just sort of telling it like it is and how she feels. You know what I mean? I don't know if that's even something that to make a distinction. Does that make sense? I don't know.
I think that I mentioned the lyrics, how much I like them. But one of the things I like is the second verse, which is, I love you much. It's not enough. You love blow and I love puff. And life is like a pipe and I'm a tiny penny rolling up the walls inside, which I think is like such a great lyric.
So for me, Amy Winehouse, I was very, like in the day when her albums were coming out, I was very aware of her. She was very popular, but I didn't have any albums and I didn't listen to her. I didn't seek it out, but it was on the radio and my wife actually, I believe, played it relatively often at the time too. She liked the, loved her. So when we did the song, I really had to listen to it. It was kind of like listening to it for the first time. But, you know, I definitely, that piano bit and the sort of the way it kind of moves along, dun, 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 that was in my head. I remember that. But I never really sat down and listened to it and let it flow over me, as they say. And I have to say, I really loved the song. I was, you know, I always knew she was a great singer and very talented. But again, I didn't very much scratch the surface for me. And yes, Mike had mentioned Rehab. That was another big song. And I actually didn't care for that one that much either. I mean, again, I didn't think it was a bad song, but it didn't really do much for me. Didn't turn my head. But this one, I think, is substantially better. I like this kind of song more than that one. Maybe it's just the subject matter or the attitude she's taking or something. I don't know. But I do love this one a lot more. And yeah, again, great instrumentation and production. That was a very astute move by Ronson, knowing how to really showcase her talents and her idea to make it sort of emulate those old bands was really smart too. Her voice is fantastic and perfect for that kind of thing. Yeah.
So is her bouffant.
Yeah, like it's boofy. Very theatrical, dramatic. And one thing I love about the song is like it gets to this breakdown, like this bridge where everything kind of stops and the tempo changes and it's completely like sort of stops and then kind of winds its way up again into what we have been used to, like the beginning part. Love that kind of stuff in a song. So yeah, I really do like the song. Perhaps I will get into Amy Winehouse more, listen to it a little bit more now, or maybe I won't. I'm just saying that.
It's only two albums.
Oh, man, two albums?
I mean, for now.
But yeah.
The song has been covered a lot too. I just want to point that out. This is like one of those songs that's become very iconic for a lot of different people. I mean, Beyonce covered it for a Baz Luhrmann movie.
Which movie? Name the movie.
Great Gatsby.
Ooh, no one. Who saw that? I didn't see that.
I didn't see it. I just know that they did it in the soundtrack and also for the trailer. So
I didn't see it either. I heard it was actually just a pretty good Gatsby.
Oh,
passable Gatsby.
But I like how it's described because they use it for the trailer. The description that I was reading said it's a dark, slow, moody interpretation. I'm like, the song's already slow and dark and moody.
Okay. Anything else on this one?
I would go back to what you said, Matt, about that break, and it's that sort of long, almost uncomfortable, like, wait, is the song ending? It's kind of like that moment at the show when you're seeing a live show and you think the song's ending and like half the people start clapping and then the other half are like, idiots, the song is not over. And I've been both. But it has that, you know, that kind of lingering, like, oh, is it just kind of fading out? And then no, it's winding back up. And it's I love it when an artist is willing to play with it like that and extract more kind of, it's not just attention, but it's kind of like you know, when you're listening to music, so much of music, from my understanding, again, I'm no music theory guy. I'm not a musician at all. But especially when, like, a lot of music, it satisfies what you're expecting to hear next, you know, like the consonants of the notes or the chords. And I'm sure I'm speaking in this incorrectly, but I think the idea is correct that, you know, you expect music to go to a certain place and it's very satisfying when it does. But there are times when an artist is willing to just like prolong something or really defy your expectations that really grabs you both, I think, intellectually, but also emotionally.
Totally. I read something about, like when I was like looking at different studies and things about people's opinions on songs, whether they think they're perfect or about what makes a great song. And a lot of like music theorists and stuff say that, you know, a song that's really, it's often very popular is one that takes you to the place you think it's going to go for the most part. It satisfies that part of your brain that goes, oh, after this chord and note, this one would sound really nice to me, you know, again, music theory stuff, but does a little change up in there enough to make you go, oh, that's different, but it still works. Not too crazy, you know, but just enough to give it a little more interest. And I think, and the studies or the people say that that's what makes people really like a song. It's like, oh, this is really giving me what I expect. Oh, that's different, but I still love this. And it's sort of the sense of discovery, maybe makes it more personal or something, but that's sort of what you were talking about that kind of break there. It's just, everything drops and then it changes its feel, but then winds back. And it's really good. It is real good.
There's a quote by Pablo Picasso where he says, learn the rules like a pro so that you can break them like an artist. Hmm. And I think that's an indication of what's happened here.
Yep. Thank you, Pablo.
Do you know that Pablo Picasso was never called an asshole?
I'd heard that somewhere.
We hope you're enjoying this GenXplainers podcast. Please remember to find us and follow us on social media. And we'd much appreciate a 5-star rating on the podcast platform of your choice. Now, let's get back to the show.
Well, shall we vote?
I think it's time.
Okay. Well, Mike, go ahead.
Well, I'm going to say it's a perfect song.
Sure.
I think everything about it works beautifully. I think I love the production, the sound, her voice, the instrumentation, all of it. And I especially like the mood of the song. So for me, it's a perfect song.
Okay, well, I'm going to go next. I'm going to look at my notes here. it says, let me see, it says yes. I do think it's a perfect song for the reasons you mentioned, and it's very well produced. She has undeniable sort of magnetism and feeling to her work, and she was very, very talented, and it's a great song, and it's a perfect song.
I will vote that it is also perfect. So we gobble it all up with the turkey.
Mm-hmm. Gobble.
Nice.
The three heads of Cerberus, all three here. Arf, arf, arf.
Arf, arf, arf.
That's what Cerberus sounds like. Arf, arf, arf. I think that it's a timeless song. It sounds like it comes from decades and decades ago, but it's also immediate and now. And it's so full of her soul and her feeling, or at least as far as I'm concerned. It's a beautiful song.
Yeah. And I think that sort of, you know, she starts with this template of Shangri-La song, that's this feel of the past. But then she injects, and the producer, it all injects it with this very unique the uniqueness of her. And an emotional feeling, authenticity, I think. Emotional authenticity. Can I say that? Emotional authenticity that makes it timeless, even though it kind of feels like an old song. It's really great. So we all voted yes.
Yes, we did.
All right, so the show's over.
I had to vote yes because it was number 33, and I had voted yes on number 36. So by numbers, I had to. So.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. That's just math, folks. All right. Well, thanks, guys. Again, thank you, Mike, for bringing that. Thanks, Al, for judging with me. And I hope everyone out there enjoyed the show. Keep listening. Like and subscribe on YouTube. Keep watching on YouTube. And we'll see you next time, everybody. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.